Okay, we are back in Women Matters in July 2019. And after having had some very, how can you say, heavy discussions the last few months, we want today just to hang out a little bit and see where we are in this summer. Half year is gone already. It's incredible. So just see what's going on for us and how the future might be, how the past has been, how the present is. So that's my suggestion for today. I'm Heidi from the wisdomfactory.net. And I'm, as always, in Italy. Not always, actually. I was in Germany last week, and before, in the beginning of June, I was in South Africa. So sometimes I'm somewhere else in the world. And maybe we talk about that too a little bit, if you are interested. So now, first check in for you both.
Okay, I'm Monia. I live in Vienna. And I'm wondering if women matters, how present are they to us? As you said, Heidi, you were in Nuremberg with the Integrale Forum, I guess, and were women matters present there? And yeah, what do they matter to us? This is what I'm wondering. Is it time to transcend women matters, or is this still too early? I don't know. Okay, but I'm glad just to chat with you too. Thank you, Dorothy.
Yeah, I had the same feeling somehow. You know, I've only participated maybe three or four times, and I really valued the cross section of people and places. And I just felt like I would have more energy in terms of responding and listening and contributing, because I really have nothing in my mind about agenda for today, other than, and it's not light at all, things are going absolutely crazy in this country. This person who lives in our White House, I mean, I could just burst into sobs, is racist, and no one is standing up to him. And he's telling these Black women to go back to where they came from. I mean, unheard of behavior, low, ignorant, dangerous. And we're just heartbroken. My husband burst into tears this morning. I had to hold him. I mean, we're really scared, and I'm not scared so much for my own personal safety, but it's like a psychic fear and an emotional fear and a compassion for the brown people that are in our country that really, for once, are really getting a very clear message that the powers that be don't welcome them, don't respect them, don't honor their traditions. So I know Hungary has had a really bad time, and I know there's trouble in the world, but I've always thought of us as sort of, immune. I mean, never has there been a bag of shit living in our White House and behaving like he's behaving, and never have there been more people donating small amounts of money to keep him in office. So I'm totally ragged, you know, and I don't know how I could be light about anything, because I have so much privilege. I'm so privileged. And it's like, it's a protection that I don't really feel good about. So that's how I am today. Suffering.
I'm wondering, my daughters are Native Americans. They were both born in New York City. I've never talked to them about it, so maybe I should. But on the other hand, well, if you consider that America has about a third of the population than Europe has, so there are a lot more people here in Europe who consider this, was quite amazed, let's put it this way. But on the other hand, this is a shadow, as I perceive it, a shadow that has been suppressed a long time by green meme people who really thought they had it all and they knew it all, and these people have been forgotten. So they are really mad, and it's a kind of madness. It's a kind of, to me, it's a kind of repressed emotional anger that's boiling up here, and this is why they listen. It's my interpretation, but this shouldn't. It's not necessarily the only one. But on the other hand, it really, I guess being an American, it must be terribly upsetting.
Especially when you are from a different level of development, no? Mm-hmm. than this person mm-hmm. is. Mm-hmm. And I start to see racism as not existent, but only the levels of development and the ignorance which comes from lower levels, which see only themselves as the right, because racism is also the other way around. In Africa can be racism against the whites. So it's not that it is against always against blacks. It depends really what culture you have created and where you live in. And as Monia says, there were enough people probably in America who haven't been hurt with the fear they have. In their traditional way of seeing the world, everything went away. It's not necessarily the guilt of or the making of the green people, but it's also technology. Everything is getting out of their control, and they fear. That's out of fear, and nobody ever has acknowledged that they have fear. Nobody ever has given them an orientation, how they could see the world, how they could live into this world without being in fear of any annihilation. You say that?
What?
Sterben, also dass sie aussterben.
They are annihilated, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah. Tell me.
Dorothy, you? It's the fear behind not, they lost their jobs, they are retiring with hardly any money, social security is, I don't know, the health system is not existent, or at least in parts, Obama tried. And fear motivates to extremes.
Yeah, and especially you need a scapegoat. And in this case, the scapegoat is the blacks, or, you know, as the far left has the scapegoats, the white, straight male, you know. That's a really stupid way of being in the world. I don't know how to say that. Get separated. Me against the others. We against the others, you know?
Is it still politically correct to speak of colored people? Or is this no longer colored?
I don't know.
It's people of color, or, you know, all of a sudden the vocabulary doesn't matter because it's turned into a heightened a disparity in injustice. A policeman who gave a chokehold to a partly retarded man who was selling cigarettes in order to supplement his wages in Staten Island, New York. He killed him, and the man kept screaming, "I can't breathe, I can't breathe." And he just was exonerated. And so it's like, you know, the country doesn't belong to us anymore, to those of us, you know, who have values that I share, that welcome the immigrants and believe people should have. I mean, it's just so depolarized. And it's just no fun. It's just not a nice time to be here. Moni, I would be very interested in what your American-born daughters have to say.
I'm going to ask.
Mm-hmm. Oh, look, there's someone else.
Hey, Gertrud, that's nice to see you. We were starting to say how we are, how we feel, and you are still here with the name of Bill. I have to change your name. Dorothy was so upset about what is going on in her country, so we ended up here.
Racism was in the back of our, yeah. And we just wanted to have a very casual... You can't escape. You can't escape what is. That's the truth. Gertrud, how are you?
I'm fine. I had a nap, which lasted a little longer than expected. Mm-hmm. I'm here and it's fine. And of course, I'm following the news, and I can resonate with what you say, Dorothy. I just got a glimpse of what you were saying, but mm-hmm. I know the deeper. So I follow American news actually as well.
So. Where are you? Where are you?
Germany. Going? Germany.
Oh, okay.
Middle, yeah. North of Frankfurt.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. So. I don't know. I just don't think that, I mean, you can talk shadow. I understand shadow, and you can talk repressed emotions, and you can talk ignorance. But when it comes down to it, you know, in my opinion, and I'm a really big optimist, you know, the climate crisis and the political crisis and the immigrant crisis, it's just too many crises for me. And I don't find comfort, Moni, when you talk about it. I can see that it's a deep part of your value system and belief system, and, you know, where you find comfort and explanation. But it's sort of like that's blown up for me. You know, it's sort of like it's not holding water with the reality of the day-to-day life and the day-to-day reality of people who are in camps and, you know, people who are, I don't know, the intellectual or philosophical or spiritual more. I guess I have a break in my faith. You know, I don't know, there must be a word for it when all of a sudden all you feel is despair and you can't build a structure of meaning and hope around it. I mean, I don't mean to dump out. I mean, I really wanted to postpone this because I knew I was just filled with this huge urgency. And, you know, I really didn't want to bring this American piece of woundedness, you know, into the context of really Europe, European women who are looking at things from a distance a little bit more and practicing their practices and keeping themselves healthy and afloat. I feel like, you know, I'm not really afloat anymore.
I don't think that this observation is true, because I think it's a worldwide phenomenon. Which is infiltrating Europe as well. I mean, when you see the Brexiteers and AfD, what they call Alternative for Germany, Italy or the alt-right in France or so. This is, there is something, I followed a conversation lately, where it's about how we see the world, or how we, I mean, the white Europeans, the white Americans see the world, and this old world is in danger. this, we are the top of the mountain and like Browning of America, this for some people, it feels like a danger. And so they have to fight that. And for us, it's the refugees or whoever. So you can, one time it was the Jews, you know, it's this, my, how I want to have the world. I don't want the world to change for me. So I need to do something. And I think being deterred, being, frustrated, that's part of the game. That's what is intended, that people don't do anything about it. Just retire in their homes and don't speak up, don't.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so we can postpone this, make America great, white again.
So.
Or here, it's similar. It's not exactly the same, but it's very similar. So it's not only your thing. So when you talk, I listen also with an European ear that resonates quite a bit.
So what I want to bring in here, I was in the African conference. And the very very first speaker said, it was not, you know, colonialism that Europeans colonized the world. It's not about, not even about detracting the goods of other countries. The worst thing which Europeans have done is exporting their way of thinking, their philosophy, which is now infiltrated practically the whole world. Everybody tries to be exactly like we have Europeans, Americans, how they think the world is and should be. And that really gave me to think a real lot. And I agree with Gertrude that at the moment, this way of thinking and of doing and being, which we think is so normal, which we don't even realize that it is guiding our our lives, that this is breaking down. And on all parts, there is fear. It's fear on your part, Dorothy. It's fear on the white nationalists or whoever it is, AfD, on the Italian super conservative party, when they fear that the migrants will overrun them. I was in South Africa and the migrants there, there are so many migrants from all the countries around. You know, and they get somehow integrated and they don't make a fuss like we do. But that's because they are, in my opinion, nearer to life still. They don't expect so much from life. They try to survive mainly. Many people try to survive, although there is the whole range of how can you say, status. But they... How can I say? They are mainly, when we talk about the levels of development, the most part of the country is in beige and purple, and then red. And then the very few people are in higher stages of development, and they somehow try to create their own reality, but they also buy into this European dream, and now they get sold out to China. And that's the other thing I wanted to say. When Peter Rosling, no, Hans Rosling, who is doing the statistics, studying all the statistics which are available and then makes it in graphic form, he says, Americans and Europeans in a very short time, they are outnumbered by at least, the importance will be in Asia. What we are doing is sort of the last breath of trying to be somebody, but in a few generations, we don't count anymore. So if you are in America, black or white, it doesn't matter because, you know, time will probably change very, very, very quickly and in to the favor of Asian people, which, by the way, which I have learned when I went to Germany, I listened to an audio book. about the intelligent brain. It was about intelligence, and it's highly politically incorrect. But there are a lot of researchers which say it was about America, the research done in America. The ethnic group with the highest quote of intelligence are the Asians, then comes the white, and then come the blacks. So it's not only black-white thing, but you know, we are sort of excluding that there are other people too, and not only blacks and whites. So I just want to redimension a little bit the whole thing, because to reduce it to racism between black and white in America, or we here, native Europeans against immigrants, which are black normally, it's too short a vision in my opinion.
And that shouldn't even matter. Hmm. I mean, it's like, I'm not sure how I feel about these, not politically correct, but I'm not sure how that is conducted and how well that is researched, and so the racial thing. But I don't know. It's like one of my daughters has a half Mozambican friend, and then everybody, what do your parents say? And say, oh, well, they like him. And yeah, but what do they say? And she did not understand what they what they were asking. So it's like, yeah, and so what? I mean, it's if the for me, it's different if it's Asian heritage, Asian racial, whatever, or the Chinese government wanting to impose their way of doing things or their political. So it's if it's a power game, that's different. But so what? I mean, it's for me, it's about humans. And how much they are connected, white, black, square, whatever. So I think it's this feeling we become a minority and we don't have the say anymore. We cannot colonize anymore. We don't have the power then anymore. This is like what we fear.
But I guess that's mostly economics. I mean, what do you personally fear? Mm-hmm. And what I'm trying is, what is my reality? And to think ahead two generations, although I have grandchildren, is just, it's their business to settle things, in my opinion. But why do we want to be scared?
Well, I don't know if we want to. I don't want to be scared. It's in response to what I see that's dangerous. I think if you see something that's dangerous and life destroying and disrespectful and damaging, then there a fear comes up. That's what I'm saying. You know, I'm not in charge anymore. I don't know if the Democrats are going to be able to grasp the power and turn things again in a direction I believe in. But when I see people not having health care, and when I see children locked up who want to come into this country, that's very scary to me, Moni. I don't want to feel scared. It's a visceral reaction to, oh my God, you know, yeah. This is wrong. This is dangerous. This is damaging, you know, and that's what, and then, you know, to not feel like any of my, I haven't listened to my Buddhism things for quite a while. I'm like paralyzed. You know, to listen and see if I can get some distance or some foundation of trust in life or in, you know, maybe that would help me. But at this point, I've sort of tossed, I haven't read a book in probably 2 months. Mm. I can't concentrate on a book. Mm. And, you know, all I do is write checks and send them to the American Civil Liberties Union. You know, I'm functioning on a level that ordinarily is not a level I function on. And I wonder how many of us, the we, you know, are actually being derailed and not finding a solid ground at a time when it's so essential. You know, I wonder what it was like for the Germans when the Nazi thing started and people could see what was happening and they had no control over it. I mean, I kind of feel like I'm in that position where I'm going, well, what should I do? What can I do? You know, should I go to Texas and sit there, a 77-year-old woman, you know, on a blanket and witness those centers? I mean, what's important? What's powerful that I can do? It's like a helpless feeling.
What would bring you to your center again? You said you haven't read books. I know that's a phase that you, when you can't read books, but what would bring you into your center, into your horror, into being balanced, not ignoring anything, but being balanced in yourself? I would recommend breathing. I mean, that's the only thing that's really of ultimate importance to us, to breathe and to come on to control our breath and not to go terrible panic. What's going on? I can't do anything. I am lost.
But I can really understand that feeling, you know.
It's absolutely
clear. And what you say about when it happened in Germany, I always said I wouldn't have been liked to be around at that time, because I wouldn't have known what to do, and probably I would have been overwhelmed. And so we have two things. One is the thing, how can I stay in my own peace, and with that be maybe able to find something which I could do, or give way to this panic, which I'm very much, you know, very prone to do too. And then when we are in this state of dissest, how do you say, of being out of yourself, let's say, then the helplessness
dissociate somehow.
the being so confused and the helplessness won't help us at all to find anything. Where in the other state, maybe we can find some little thing which we could do. I don't know. That's what I think. And I really sympathize with you, Dorothy, because I have lived the last year since Mark died more or less in a state of, what shall I do? Because then it was not the refugees which were so much bothering me, but death and you know, and what to do and how to organize my property, how to continue to live, and these things. It was more personal, but still it was some sort of, you know, what can I do? And I feel helpless, and I was in a bad psychological state, I would say. And what the reason is at the end, it's the same, but the to come to some insight or some solution, we need to go to this other space. And I recognize that it's not so easy, even with breathing and everything. You know, it takes also time in my case.
With breathing, yeah.
I would like to go a little bit Eagle's view. I think your personal thing, I can very much see how that unfolded, and I'm completely resonating with you, Dorothy. And there is something that this is fear physiologically, it does the same thing, no matter where it comes from. So it shuts down the brain, and you go on the stem brain, and then you only have attack, fight, flight, or freeze. And what I heard from you is a freeze mode. It's this helplessness. And I would say it's intended, not by you, but by those who do that stuff.
Yeah.
It's intended.
Go on.
And I would say they are all in this, we call it red mode. So this adrenaline mode. The fighters, like your president, that attack no matter what. And those people that think it's their country. I mean, they are all immigrants besides the natives, each and everyone. So, and to have that, like, we are in danger because it's our country, and those should go back to their countries, though they were born in it's just crazy.
It is and crazy.
I think it's intended. It's intended to invoke fear.
Yep.
Among those who you want to attack.
Right.
And that they are helpless and cannot fight back or cannot defend themselves and cannot do whatever. And I think in Nazi Germany, it was the same. There were people that were afraid because the Gestapo could come, or I was talking to my father and he said, the least invasive I could do to be in the Nazi student organization, no? So I didn't have to enter the party. And you had to send your kids to the youth thing. So there were so many things where you didn't know if you talked at home that somebody would in school or so tell it to the teacher and then it would go on. So there is this invoking of fear that a whole majority is like in freeze mode. And sometimes I'm thinking, the Democrats, how do they behave? And there are many of them, they are really in helplessness mode. And that, I think it's intentional. And Margaret Albright, she wrote a book about fascism. And she says, this is not, it's not, it was not, and now it is. And, you know, like an invasion, and it's creeping in.
I can resonate to that, and I have been wondering about subtle energies, which we are not aware of, unconscious, and to me it's also part of the media hype, like the climate catastrophe. It's also something to fill the summer hole. In the media, they have something to write about, they have something to talk about. But we in Austria, we had a couple of hot days and now it's normal again. So hyping fear, and this is what it's about. How do we meet that? And to me, it's important, how do I meet subtle energies that, as you said, Gertrud, that sneak in to your unconscious even. And I notice it mostly in my dreams, when all of a sudden things turn up in dreams that I wouldn't be aware of in everyday life, in normal, in better mode. But you mentioned the word mode. So to be aware in what mode I am is, to me, very important. And I address that. I'm telling him now I'm in my energy saving mode. And I had a very cute drawing, which I'm going to send to you, because this is a little bird just lying there and its legs spread out and I can't move. And I'm not lazy. I'm just in my energy saving mode. But to be aware of what is going on in us, not just from the outside, is to me still, Buddhist or not, very important.
We are just, I was in Nice, I think I said that, in the World Appreciative Inquiry Conference, and met there so amazing people that really, in the face of threats, and do the work anyway. So it was really like heartwarming to see from the whole globe people in Bolivia doing work, working with little girls to support their self awareness and self consciousness and self protection. And so there we decided to revive the European Appreciative Inquiry and I was a little bit not knowing what comes to me. I said, yes, we will do an European conference for appreciative inquiry. And our title is Appreciative Inquiry and the for the Climate. And this is meant for the climate in business, in society, and for the planet. And now we are creating that to do a big summit. I mean, to do the work with the people, not to have keynote speakers and all this, but to do the work with all those people that, yeah, how can we make a difference? And one of the questions we asked what would happen if, leading questions. What would happen if we really listened? Or if wholeness was the leading value, what effect would it have on business, society, and the planet? So that's the leading question, is the one that is like the umbrella under which all the workshops take place. So there's so many young people. If we just give them that space in which they can appear, we don't have to do so much. They want to do. But to give them the support they need to change the world and to make it another place, because the young people, they are racially mixed. They have classmates of all colors in the US and even here in Germany now after many refugees came. So they don't have that problem of white old people. We're just talking with ISEC, that's a student organization to create internships in different countries, and so, and to have them all in the room and work with them, and that was really lightening up my heart, and not for me doing so much, but for me providing what I can provide, holding space, an appreciative space in which people listen to each other and come up with solutions that I couldn't think of.
What I hear you say with some other words would be also that we can be a sort of a mentor, share our experience, but let them do theirs, but sort of helping them not to need to reinvent every wheel, but only the wheels which need to be reinvented somehow. Yeah.
Share our experiences, but let them make their own experiences.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to say. Yeah. Maybe it didn't
and
come
over. I was really going in resonance with what Gertrude said about lightening up your heart. Dorothy, what is lightening up your heart right now?
I know. I it's so good that as I listen to this, because ordinarily I engage, you know, it really is a thing of being frozen. You know, it's sort of a frozen reaction because I'm not really engaging like I usually do. You know, we're working with kids here in the schools, you know, to get them. I mean, I just have a lot of areas like Gertrude, you know, where my heart would lighten with the hope and with the witnessing what's going on. And I guess just in the, I was sick last week, very sick, 4 days of really being sick. Mm. And it kind of just pulled me into a new place that's horribly, you know, trapping. And I'm not doing any of the things, you know, I'm not listening to Tara Brach and meditating and, you know, doing the exercises. And, you know, I haven't been running to Namaste Point and pouring my heart out with gratitude and with hopefulness. And, you know, listening, I really have shut down. It's been like, you know, a prairie dog who sticks their head up, sees something horrible and then goes back underneath. And it's not good. It, you know, it's immobilizing. And I don't want to stay in this place. You know, I this isn't a place that I would choose to stay. I mean, I've slipped into it and I've kind of burrowed in with the comfort of the misery, but you know, I can't stay like this.
I think it's when you are in that mode, then there is, then this is a physiological thing. So you have adrenaline going all the way through and you cannot move because you're frozen. then you need to get the adrenaline out of your body. Just physiologically, pure physiology, not any thoughts of gratitude and all this. This is, you have to come back to a thinking being. This is not, I mean, it has a grip on you and you need to do something about your body, not so much the other stuff, because that needs somebody who is already there, who is present. And in that mode, you cannot be present because it's just reaction. It's just this reflexive mode, like a treadle. Goes back and that's it. So may I suggest a little bit?
Yes, so please do.
So the breathing is very good. This is and not here but in the belly. And I've learned so-called oxytocin breath, which is that you first exhale so everything goes out and then you let your breath come in, and with a second exhale you make a sound which is like HA, so ha, and the angles of your
smile.
Mouth. Yeah, you have to pretend it because at first you don't have anything to smile about, but just your facial.
Let's just do it together.
That. So like. You really have that sound and not. And when you do that 3-4 times, then the adrenaline goes down and the oxytocin goes up. And then you can reconnect and have that mode lowered. And when you do that several times a day, even if you're not in stress, then you can just lower that adrenaline level, just as a regular practice.
Well, of course, there are also other ways. I just throw up. If things really are that nauseating, I just throw up and then I'm fine again. No, it's don't laugh. I don't know why it's easy for me to throw up. It happened last night, and there are a couple of things that really, that really made me feel sick. And then I throw up, and then I know, my body is still there, and my brain is still there, and my heart is still there, and I'm fine again. And then the next day I go on a diet, whatever, no inputs, whatever, and rice wafers for food. And my husband is very cooperative because, he understands finally that people have a different sensitivity towards things. And to be aware, as I said, to be aware of subtle energies is not easy, because it really, it also can make you sick.
Movement, really not staying in the chair, just going out, shaking, whatever, whole body, the limbs. Going out for a walk, with movement, because it's adrenaline is made for immediate access to movement. Yeah. And if we don't, in the frozen state, we don't move, and so the adrenaline doesn't go out. If you fight or fly, if you flee, then you have it, the body takes care of itself. But in the frozen mode, you have to do it. You have to force yourself to get up and move.
I want to share something from South Africa. As soon as there is something like a rhythm or music, people begin to move. And I was so astonished about the open eyes and the joyfulness of people, even if they are not well off, And when you say that, the movement, I do think that has to do with that, because they are all the time in movement. Yeah, we are sitting, but they, whenever they, when they are happy or whatever it is,
I'm wondering, are you familiar with Osho meditations? Because he has movement meditations. So when you really feel that the energy is just stuck, then you jump or whatever. I have a couple of them. I haven't used them in a long time, but maybe I should take them out again. Yeah. And when I don't listen to the news anymore, my husband always reports to me, so I still am up to date. But jumping and I always go, I go out every day, because this is necessary to move. Yeah.
Thank you.
And laughing. Laughing is one of the best things.
I know.
Laugh together with others.
I know.
There is also this meditation where you cry for a quarter of an hour and you laugh for a quarter of an hour.
Wow.
It's, I don't know what it's called. I have to look it up. I have so many, so many tools.
We have talked almost an hour.
About nothing.
No, it was very important. But I'm wondering to make around and see how do we feel now? How is it? Is there a difference from the beginning to now? What in which state are we now, or in which also mood, but also in which place, I would say?
Well, I appreciate so much getting so much of your attention and suggestions and caring, and it's all familiar to me. I'm a therapist. I say the same things to people who feel like I do. But it's really amazing how, I can't circle it back around to me. I mean, eventually, and by admitting it to you and I went running yesterday for the first time. And so I really feel like I've gotten a real, a squad, a rally squad of caring women with all kinds of suggestions that really give me a whole new, not permission, but encouragement to pick up the pieces. And, you know, I've gone back to the news again, just out of my morbid, frozen state. You know, I'll watch it and listen, and my husband walks into the room and I'm, you know, kind of ashamed, but I'm doing it. And I just think I'm done with that. And there are things I've been wanting to work on and plan and garden, and I just haven't done any of that. And of course I'm, you know, deprived. I'm starving for what I need most. So I feel different and I feel hopeful, and the world can go on, and, you know, I can take my place and do what I need to do. Thank you. Many thanks. Vielen Dank.
I feel, again, that whatever you give others, you give yourself. So whatever you share, you are rewarded with. And feeling Dorothy's frozenness. Yeah. It really touches me. And I can mentally understand it, but I can also emotionally follow her, how she fights. But I know she will fight, because I'm a fighter, and maybe I want everybody else to be a fighter as well. It's not just becoming passive and wallowing in your sorrow and in your misery and in your anger. And yeah, thank you all very much for being present.
I was a little bit at the beginning. I try to go in the mind, no, and find explanations for the outside things which you said, what is happening, no, and so to understand what is going on in the world, and spiral dynamics and integral theory is a good tool to understand it, which doesn't mean that we can handle it, the situation. And I felt so connected with you, Dorothy, especially when you said at the end, you know all that, the advices you get, you already know them, but you still cannot get out, because I was in this situation not long ago, and also before, you know. And actually, to me, sometimes it's annoying when people tell me the things which I actually know, and and I just don't get it done. I just don't find the what is it, the power, or is it the decision? Because for me, it is a state of almost depression when I am in this space. So I felt a little bit uncomfortable with people, you two, giving too much unasked advice for, but I hope, as you say, Dorothy, and Gertrude, at a certain moment you asked for the permission, that's okay. But out of my own experience, I know that sometimes it's, you don't want to hear that. Because it reminds you even more of your inability, you know, to get out of this situation. But fortunately, we get out. Maybe it takes some time, but we will get out, and you are getting out, and that's fine. I'm really happy about that, and I'm glad that you shared that so personally, how can you say, so authentically with us, and be with us in this.
Thank you.
I just remember the Zauberflöte, mm-hmm. when Papageno says, ich narr vergaß die Zauberdinge. Yes. The fool I am, I forgot my magic tools. And that's the way it is. It's just, we have to be reminded of them. And in a group, it's easier to remember, is my experience.
For me, I had bad consciousness that I came too late. And so I was like, let me hear what's going on. And then we're in the middle. And I think where I, for me, there was this moment when you said, I know all the tools and I have all this, but I cannot do anything at the moment. And then I realized it's really like on being on stem brain. And then it's not about thinking or doing. So it was like, I had that physiological urge to say, breathe. You said breathe, but then I said, do it right now. Like this, that was my impulse. And it was not to impose anything. It was just when you, the way you talked, I thought, breathe now. Not as a concept. So
and we did, and that was good.
Yes. For the heart chakra. It's the heart.
And that's why I it was almost like, come on, do it. Thank you that you let me do that. And I can understand Heidi. And that's why I asked afterwards. But at that moment, I just had to do that.
Yeah, I can. It was not meant as a blame, but just as a reminder, no? That sometimes it's when you get all the good advices then, and you are in a place where you really don't want to hear that because you know what the problem is, but you just cannot grasp it for yourself. But that we did the breathing, I would have suggested even to do it more longer and not to talk for 5 minutes or 10 minutes.
Right now.
Okay.
So let's end with a big common breath again on the heart chakra. And another one.
You are. What a gift. Thank you very much. No matter how often you heard it, if you're not saying it to yourself, it's not yours. So it's lovely when it comes from others to you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. And it was a surprising encounter, you know, open.
As always.
Wonderful. So let's see in August when you have time and we see what comes out of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Namaste.